Welcome to Public Health On Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Our focus is the novel coronavirus. I'm Josh Sharfstein, a faculty member at Johns Hopkins and also a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal with this podcast is to bring evidence and experts to help you understand today's news about the novel coronavirus and what it means for tomorrow. If you have questions, you can email them to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, Stephanie Desmon speaks to Dr. Morgan Katz, a geriatrician and infectious disease specialist at Johns Hopkins. They discuss how nursing homes have become hotspots for COVID-19 and what nursing homes will look like after the pandemic. Let's listen.
Thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you for having me. I'm really excited to be here.
Today, I'd like to ask you some questions about nursing homes. But first, could you tell our listeners a little bit about your background with long-term care facilities?
Sure. So I'm an infectious disease physician at Hopkins, and I really started my career actually doing some consulting at long-term care facilities during fellowship. I was helping them to review antibiotics and residents that were having issues with infections in those facilities. And when I was there, I identified a lot of issues in terms of infection prevention and antibiotic use. And since then, really dedicated my research to making infection prevention more feasible in nursing homes, understanding some of the challenges and the resource limitations they have there. So in terms of the response to COVID, I've been helping to guide facilities in their practices to try and prevent transmission throughout the facility.
We're hearing that nursing homes have become hotspots around the country. So many of those who die got sick while they were in nursing homes. I know that older folks are at a greater risk of dying from COVID, but is that enough to explain why nursing homes are such hotspots?
Well, you know, I think you have two factors. So first of all, you have your most vulnerable community, right? That have high comorbidities and are typically older. And then you have them in a group living situation, which is really why these are hotspots, right? The transmission is so easy in this setting because they're living in groups. They're really unable to adequately socially distance. Even when you're isolating residents to their room, they require constant care by staff that has to, you know, perform hands-on care multiple times a day. So transmission is really easy in these settings.
Is it something specific to COVID, or are there just a lot of infections that happen in a setting like this?
It's actually, you know, COVID has been especially challenging, but this is something that we've seen in long-term care from the beginning. And this is why I focus a lot of my research in this setting. We do see high rates of antibiotic resistance in this setting due to the many challenges on both an individual level with the resident as well as a facility and system-wide level. These are patients that have high exposure to the healthcare setting and, you know, require more care than you would expect.
So what are you advising nursing homes to do in terms of helping stem the spread?
So there's a lot of things. So first of all, before this started, the idea was to try and prevent introduction into the facility. And we thought that that would be possible by, limiting visitors and performing really proactive symptom screening of the staff, as well as performing normal infection prevention procedures like increasing hand washing and making sure that environmental cleaning was really improved. However, unfortunately, what we've seen is that just doing symptom screening of the staff is not enough because there's so many people that are completely asymptomatic. So even if staff are being really vigilant about not coming to work when they have symptoms or catching them by temperature screens, they're still able to introduce it into the facility because they don't have symptoms and aren't being tested. So moving forward, and what we realized in some of our early interventions was to do more widespread testing and try and capture and discover these asymptomatic staff and residents before spread could occur.
So have you been able to do testing, or like everywhere there are shortages of tests, or have been?
Yeah, so early on in the pandemic, there was a huge shortage in tests. And that was one of the big things that I helped to do serving as the long-term care incident commander at Hopkins. So the real goal was there. We were able to get together a testing team at Hopkins with great help from one of my medical students, Ben Bigelow. He's amazing. And a whole team from the ambulatory testing tent. And we would actually go out to the facilities that had several positive or symptomatic residents that were not able to obtain these tests through their local health department. And we would perform more widespread testing throughout the facility. So we would either test the entire facility or the entire exposed unit. And what we identified there was that there was a huge number of positive patients that were completely asymptomatic. It was actually up to about 70%. We, you know, by performing the initial measures by only testing the symptomatic residents, we were not able to really capture and isolate the positive cases.
Which is why it kept spreading.
Exactly.
So if you testing everybody is helpful, obviously. Testing staff is like a double-edged sword in some ways. I mean, obviously, you want to catch those who are ill so they don't spread it. But at the same time, you probably end up in settings where you don't have enough staff because they turn out to be positive.
Yeah, agreed. And this is what we've seen really across the board. The facilities, while they want to prevent the spread, they're hesitant to test all their staff at once, because if you lose all your staff, you don't have anyone to care for these residents. So it really is a catch-22 and something that you need to strategize before you perform widespread staff testing.
What kind of strategizing?
So I recommend, you know, trying to test in groups, making sure that you have a crisis plan should all your staff test positive. Most of these staff are recommended to sign up for these staff agencies, which also can be a challenge because then you have staff that are traveling to several facilities and they may be traveling to an outbreak facility and actually introduce COVID into your facility. There's just so many challenges here and so many things that these facilities have to think about. And even when they're, you know, really doing everything they can, unfortunately, inadvertently, that can introduce it into the facility as well.
Mm-hmm. I've heard that sort of was one of the first outbreaks was a result of a staff member going from one facility to another.
Yeah, we've seen this pretty commonly across the board.
So in the future, I mean, all of us are sitting here afraid to go beyond the grocery store, right? But we all have parents who might someday need long-term care. What is the future of long-term care going to look like?
Yeah, I mean, I think these are questions that are starting to come up because obviously this is a really long time for these residents to not be able to have visitors. And I think that that was a reasonable and a good requirement to put in place at the start. But at some point, we need to start letting these people interact with each other again and see their family members. So I think that there's ways to think about that, doing that safely. And one is, you know, first, I think it really is important for them to have more access to testing and have repeated access to testing. So, you know, I think a common misconception is one sweep of a universal test gives us the answer, but, you know, that can change the next day. For example, we tested one facility, the whole facility, and about 50% of the facility was infected. And we went back in 7 days later and tested all the negatives, and 25% of them were subsequently positive. So it really is just giving us a moment in time. And we need to, you know, remember that it's not the final answer. In terms of moving forward, yeah, I think having access to repeated testing, tests on site that can give us answers, and we can really contact trace and isolate on site, not have to wait for tests to be delivered for days, is going to be really important. And then thinking about how to make visits safe. I think coming in the warmer months, starting to think about outdoor visits, we have seen that, you know, there's definitely reduced transmission in the outdoors, especially if you're keeping your distance. So trying to do some outdoor visits to help keep, you know, the morale up, I think is going to be really important moving forward.
Do you think people in the future might be reluctant to have their parents living in these facilities?
No, it's possible, but I will say the one thing that may come out of this is that I think there are going to be more resources devoted to improving infection prevention. I think this has been something that's been overlooked for so long, and now we are really starting to understand that these facilities need resources, they need support, they need collaboration with health systems as well as the state. So really, every facility should be teamed up with an acute care hospital and get some of their infection prevention guidance and get their resources. It's a collaboration. We're sharing patients. We should be sharing education and knowledge as well.
What would you say is perhaps the biggest lesson so far that you've learned?
Wow. I've learned so much, I think, about politics in all of this, and you know, how important really a partnership is, and learning to partner both public health as well as the private public sector, and how important that is going to be to help these facilities move forward. I've also learned just how strong some of these staff members are. I've been so impressed by the many people that are going to work and how much they care for these residents, even if it was, you know, some of the most challenging of circumstances. So that has been really amazing to see.
Do you think there are other things that you'll learn going forward after once this has passed?
Yeah, absolutely. I feel like I'm learning so much every day, not only about this virus and the transmission, but also about how to make infection prevention feasible in this setting and the changes that need to be made moving forward.
Well, Morgan Katz, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for listening to Public Health on Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Please send questions to be covered in future podcasts to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. This podcast is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Lamare Morales. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker and Spencer Greer, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.